Well, welcome to BPD in the community. I'm Sergeant William West, and I have a panel of officers here to my right. I'm starting with Lieutenant Gregory Katz, off to my far right, Officer Cory Bandouveres, to my right, and right to my immediate right is Detective Edward Peterson. They're all military veterans, and we're here to support the veterans in the community as well as anywhere in the United States. And we're here to celebrate Veterans Day. So first of all, we're going to talk about a little bit about their military service and how they became involved in policing. So Lieutenant Katz, how are you today?
Very well. Thanks, Bill.
Thanks for coming on the show today.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Thank you. So what branch of military service were you in, sir?
I was in the Air Force.
Okay. And what made you decide to go in the Air Force?
I was always interested in service. I was always interested in the military. Initially, I got out of high school. I went to college for a year. I went to Wentworth Institute of Technology in Boston. Mm-hmm. And I was really interested in engineering and drafting and stuff like that. And probably about 8 months in, I said, I really don't like sitting at a desk, mm-hmm. Which of course now is what I do. But at the time, I just want a little bit more. And not sure why I picked the Air Force. I like the technology. I like the aircraft and the mission. So I went in as a security specialist. Mm-hmm. And my first assignment was Pease Air Force Base right here. It's kind of closed now. It's mm-hmm. just Air National Guard now. But so I did a couple of years there. Desert Storm happened. I went over to Saudi Arabia for a while. And then I also went to, I was at Tyndall Air Force Base. Mm-hmm. Which unfortunately just got hit by that hurricane. They're having a tough time down there. But so I was stationed down there. I got out around 92. I really enjoyed it. I think it's done a lot for me, which we'll get into, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
But so that's basically it in a nutshell.
Okay. All right.
I'll answer more questions whenever you
Absolutely.
Want to ask.
Absolutely. Officer Bandouveres, so what made you decide to join the military, and what branch were you in, sir?
I was in the Marine Corps. Mm-hmm. I was at a similar situation as Lieutenant Cates here. I got out of high school and I went to college for a year, and I was sort of lacking that direction and I wasn't really sure where I want to go. A lot of my family had served, and I had a lot of friends that had gone that route too. And speaking with them, it looked like the better option for me, and I got to say it was the best decision I ever made.
And you decided to go into the occupational skill of parachute rigger?
Correct. I was a 0451. It's a mm-hmm. parachute rigger. Pretty much the main duties are, I was assigned an air delivery unit, so our main duties revolved around personnel mm-hmm. and cargo. Mm-hmm. So we were responsible for safely delivering cargo from the airplane mm-hmm. down to the ground, as well as the personnel. Later down the line, I actually became a static line jump master. Mm-hmm. So I was responsible for organizing and ensuring the jumper safety during each and every mission. So we would run, I can't even give you a number, multiple missions mm-hmm. Every single year, just training missions. And I would assist the other jump masters, and we would get everyone safely to ground.
Okay. And as you heard, Lieutenant Cates was at Operation Desert Shield, Desert Storm. What operations were you involved with?
I was a part of Operation Enduring Freedom. Mm-hmm. It was over there in 2010. I was down in Afghanistan. We went to the Helmand Province.
Yes.
I was down there for about 8 months. Mm-hmm. And now I'm serving the community in Billerica.
Beautiful. Glad to have you. And Detective Peterson, what made you decide to go in the military, and what branch did you go in, sir?
I've had family that had been in the military in the past, mm-hmm. and it was something I was very interested in. I actually joined while I was a senior in high school. Mm-hmm. I joined the Massachusetts Army National Guard. Mm-hmm. part of the reason was education benefits. Mm-hmm. They provide a great package for you to attend state schools. Mm-hmm. I joined as a military police officer back in February of 88 mm-hmm. and went to Fort McClellan, Alabama for basic and AIT. After that, I was a member of the Mass National Guard for the next 23 and a half years until I retired in 2012.
You retired at what rank, sir?
As Command Sergeant Major.
Which is one of the highest non-commissioned officer ranks?
E9 is the highest rank that you can obtain as a non-commissioned officer.
Excellent. And now you were involved in a number of missions where you deployed overseas.
Just like Lieutenant Katz, I deployed for Operation Desert Storm back in 1990. Again, deployed, and well, after 9/11, the unit was mobilized for Operation Noble Eagle, which was providing security at Logan Airport and other critical infrastructure throughout the state. Then I deployed for Operation Enduring Freedom in 2002 to 2003. Was in Pakistan and Uzbekistan. Mm-hmm. And then 2008 into 2009, I deployed for Operation Iraqi Freedom and was stationed in Wasit Province, Iraq.
How many men were under your command?
my last deployment was, I was a first sergeant at the time, so I had 174 personnel assigned to the unit. And then right before I retired, I also did, it was kind of dual-hatted. I was the command sergeant major for the 126th Brigade Support Battalion out of Springfield, and then the 26th Maneuver Enhancement Brigade had deployed in support of Operation Enduring Freedom. And I was the rear debt sergeant major and basically in charge of the day-to-day operations of like 1,800 people.
And one of our other officers that's on the job, Officer Paul Brady, he deployed with you under your command, correct?
Actually, myself and Officer Brady and Officer Rain actually all deployed together in 02-03 mm-hmm. With the 972 Military Police Company. Mm-hmm. And then throughout our career, when you depending upon what you make, where you make rank and what units you end up to. So I know Sergeant Brady, Officer Brady ended up with the Infantry Battalion and deployed, and Officer Rain deployed again with the 211th Military Police Battalion.
Mm-hmm. Well, clearly there's some nexus between military service and the policing service. I think at least a lot of the guys we have are military veterans. I don't even know what the numbers are. Are you aware, is it 13 or 14 right now? Does that sound about right?
Right now, there's probably about 15. Okay. I know we have members of each branch of service, Coast Guard, Air Force, Navy, Marine Corps, and Army,
right.
That are members of the police department, to include yourself.
Right. And right now, on active duty is Officer Rain, so we couldn't get him here today, and Officer Hankler is also on active duty service right now.
Tell us about your
experience.
Operation Desert Shield and Operation Desert Storm, 90 and 91.
Army, right?
Yeah, with 89th MP Brigade, 210th MP Battalion, 94th MP Company. So it was good.
Yeah.
Good deployment. So now, what do you see as the differences from civilian policing to military policing and the similarities, if you would?
So I started out as a security specialist. At the time, the Air Force had two career paths there. They had security and they had law enforcement. So when I went to Tyndall Air Force Base in Florida, we kind of mixed it up a little bit. Mm-hmm. So I did get to do some law enforcement as well. Mm-hmm. I think the big difference is military members as a whole have a different code to live by. You know, the Uniform Code of Military Justice. It's a lot easier, I think, to be a military cop mm-hmm. than it is as a civilian. Mm-hmm. It's more challenging, but at the same time, usually with the military, it's a little bit of a different mission because there's a lot of force protection, installation protection, a lot more security involved mm-hmm. than just general policing. Mm-hmm. So it's similar, but I mean, if you can do the job in the military, you'll probably transition just fine to civilian. Mm-hmm. But it is quite different. I'm sure that Ed would probably agree. It's just
Your service as a combat MP. Clearly different than the type of policing we do in the civilian work.
correct. And even back, like when I first joined, and difference between the Air Force, security forces, and Army military police is the fact that security forces, like the Air Force, like you said, had two different roles. Mm-hmm. And with the MPs was one, it was not only did you do the combat mission as doing route security, force protection, but you were also responsible for law and order as well. Where Desert Storm was completely different, we didn't necessarily work as everyday police officers. It was more route security and things like that. My second deployment was force protection mm-hmm. the whole time. Mm-hmm. So Kashi Khanabad was in Uzbekistan and Jacobabad was in Pakistan. And the two platoons, so the MP company that I belonged to at the time, it was two line platoons plus a headquarters company. Two platoons were stationed at each base, mm-hmm. and our mission was force protection. So it was gate duty, it was tower duty.
Okay.
But we also did law enforcement on the base.
Right, okay.
So it's kind of one of the same. It's like Lieutenant Katz had stated, is when you go into the military, you know, they instill discipline in you. So when you're dealing with somebody on a military base, it's a little different than dealing with somebody in the general public, for the most part. But it's, you know, you still have the same sort of crime that you would have in the general public. Mm-hmm. It's just not as prevalent as it would be.
Right. So, and yourself, Cory?
Well, I don't have the military police experience per se. I would have to say the biggest difference would be just the culture itself. Like both these gentlemen said, it's just it being in the military, you kind of have that discipline integrated into your personality, and just how you live your day-to-day life. The best example I could think is when you go to the post exchange, the store. You had to dress a certain way.
Yeah.
So, for instance, I would often come from the gym, and I would have to go to my room, change out of gym shorts because I didn't have belt loops on them, and then I have to put pants with belt loops on them, put a belt on to go to the store to go back to my room. Yeah. So it was a lot of difference, and the MPs would actually come and enforce those regulations. Mm-hmm. So they would be out there sometimes just monitoring Marines going in and out and making sure they're abiding by the dress code.
He brings up a good point, because you know the thing that really the military does right in a lot of ways is the mission comes first. Mm-hmm. And when people think of the mission, they think, oh, get the planes off the ground, get the guys at the front line, get the logistics done. But it really is about culture, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're all police officers, so we have a common identity that binds us, you know, and that's one thing that a lot of military people like about policing, mm-hmm. because you're still kind of a paramilitary organization, right? Mm-hmm. But in the military, it's like everyone has personal differences, but everything is secondary to the mission, mm-hmm. to the unit, to the organization, to the branch of service you're in, and to the U.S. military, and, mm-hmm. you know, being an American with a uniform on.
Right.
So, one of the problems, you know, a lot of guys have trouble adjusting to civilian life is just that. You know, it's, you know, especially in our society right now, everything's about differences. We have to point out differences all the time. Well, you know what? What about just being Americans? But that's how it is in the military.
Yeah.
So it is a big change. And that's what a lot of, you know, when we talk about good things, I mean, there's a lot of bad things too, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, the good things happen. You're like, you know, it's about being with your unit, being with the guys together. And it didn't matter where you came from or who you are, what race you were, or what sex you were, whatever.
Right.
Everyone was part of the unit.
Right.
And it's hard to find that in the civilian world. Yes. It really is. It's gotten worse.
But it's still, like, I get asked all the time. So since I've retired since 2012, mm-hmm. I'm still friendly with a lot of people that I've served with. Mm-hmm. You know, when they ask me if I miss it, you know what I mean? And do I miss soldiering? Yes. Mm-hmm. I miss being around, you know, the members of the unit. Do I miss doing the fun stuff that we had? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, but on the other hand, and being a little different than being on from active duty to being a member of the Guard is, mm-hmm. A lot of times, like, even though I'd be deployed, I'd be put on state active duty to support the Commonwealth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so like one of my decisions to retire back in 2011 was the tornado in Springfield. Mm-hmm. You know, we were activated and sent out there. I lived in my armory for about 40 days to support people out there in the community of Springfield. And then that was the October that we got the crazy snowstorm.
Mm-hmm.
So I used to be able to get away with going on a deployment overseas wasn't bad, because my wife could kind of pick up and get her routine down. Mm-hmm. But the issue was that I used to be able to get away with telling my kids that, hey, you know, people don't have power, there's snow in their driveway, I need to go help them.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that October was, my kids are sitting there, well, Dad, we don't have power and there's snow in our driveway. And I'm like, all right, well, I guess it's time for me to go. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
You know what I mean? So, and it's hard, and even the transition from active duty to civilian life, civilian career, family, you know, your family itself, it's kind of hard to balance that where, you know, while you're on active duty is, you know, when we went down to the old guard for training for the honor guard for the police department, you know, I was talking to the young soldiers that were down there and realizing they're trying to plan their life. Like, hey, I'm either going to do 4 years and get out. They still get that discipline and instilled in them. But hey, I want to do something when I get out of here. So whether it's coming into law enforcement, fire services, EMS, tech world, you know what I mean? But it's like, it's just hard to try to transition that. And I think for me, it was an easy transition prior to me getting hired by the police department. Mm-hmm. I worked for the Department of Corrections for 12 and a half years. Mm-hmm. And it was easier for me to be able to, you know, with the job that I do, being able to support my military career, my civilian career, mm-hmm. by the changing schedule that we have within the police department, same thing at the jail, and then be able to manage my family life. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So it's just, it's, I don't know, it's kind of, once you get down there, and you guys can attest to this, is you go to basic training and mm-hmm. you're, you know, I was a 17-year-old kid. I just graduated out of Brooker High School and I'm in Alabama getting yelled at by, you know, four drill sergeants mm-hmm. because I'm the kid from the Northeast.
That's right. You don't really have to think much.
You don't think, they tell you what to do. And then even though I did obtain the rank of command sergeant major, I still had bosses. Right. So like, you know, granted I could dictate my day of, you know, but like everyone knew, like, hey, you're getting up at such and such a time to do PT. Mm-hmm. The chow hall's only open from 6 to 7 a.m. Mm-hmm. Then your work day, and then, you know, you finished your day out, and then, you know, the higher you got in rank, the more stuff you did after work. Mm-hmm. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So it was like, even on my deployments, was like, you know, the unit would do their mission of supporting the local police department in Wasset Province. Mm-hmm. But the majority of the stuff that myself and the commander would need to do took place, like, after everybody else went to bed.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's like, it's
you're
just kind of weird.
Sleep and
yeah, it's, you know, and you look at it differently and, you know, kind of, I think like my career in the military has definitely made me a better police officer, a better parent, better, you know, husband, due to the fact that like you get deployed and you understand that we take advantage of, or
take for granted
what we have.
We do.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's like, you know, I and I said it to my wife before, like her, the hardest job for my deployment when I went in 08, 09 was my kids were two years old and 8 months. Mm-hmm. So the hardest job throughout that entire deployment was my wife taking care of my two kids. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So like my day was pretty regimented, and it's, you try to carry that over even to here.
Back home.
Yeah, you know what I mean? But you try to carry that back over to here as well. You know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, if not that your day's planned out because different things happen every day here, mm-hmm. but if you know you're working at 4 o'clock, hey, your routine is at 3 o'clock, I start to get ready, I get to the station by 3:30, I get my day set up, mm-hmm. and you kind of hope that it's almost regimented to a fact, because it's just, it's easier to go through life. You know what I mean?
Like,
one of the other things is about, you know, when you're in the military and you get pushed, right? Mm-hmm. You know, whatever training you're going through, and you always think you know your limits, right?
Yeah.
But then you know, hey, well, I can do a little bit more than I thought I could.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, and a lot of times, and nothing against people who haven't served, but they don't know their limits, a lot of them. And one of the things that's helped me from the military is, you know, when things get tough, you say, I've been through worse than this.
Yeah, right?
So it does help, you know, in that regard, too. You know?
Yeah, I'd say the biggest shock I had transitioning, I was only in 4 years, so compared to Ed, that's a blink. But when I first got out, I mean, I did miss that camaraderie, that brotherhood. And I went kind of a different path before I got hired on at Billerica. I tried to go to college full time, and I did go to college full time mm-hmm. successfully.
Surprise!
That was a big culture change coming from a regimented community. I was a corporal at the time, so I had Marines under me, and I was kind of used to people listening to me when I told them, like, go over there, get this done, do this. And then I came to college, and
it's just
it was
a mess.
It was the same, but it was the same age group that I was just telling, like, go clean your room, mm-hmm. go clean the head over there, mm-hmm. go polish your boots and stuff. And then just watching them move without a purpose and just kind of walking around lackadaisical, it drove me insane. So that took me a little while just to kind of adjust to. But I acclimated slowly but surely.
Well, that's the thing too, and it's not like, you know, we talk about it. We are looked upon differently now as police officers in this day and age, but you know, you look at just the civilian community as a whole, is less than 1% are actually interested in joining the military, mm-hmm. and less 1% of the population actually think about going into the military. Mm-hmm. Out of that, only 0.5% of them, 50% of them actually make it in.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So you look at the population of the United States, mm-hmm. and you look at the end strength of all the services together, you know, it's less than 1% of the population. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So it's like,
kinda sad, isn't
and it is, well, it's not that it's sad. It is what it is, but it's, you know, like, and you speak about it in general is, you know, most people that join the service, most people that join the service and stuff like that is they're type A personalities. They want to be the best. They have drive. You know what I mean? So even as a 17-year-old kid, like, I knew what I wanted to do. And my father actually refused to sign my paperwork for my recruiter because I was 17. And my father's like, hey, listen, my kid doesn't know what he wants to have at breakfast tomorrow. Never mind. Do for the next 6 years. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, but, and like I said, as I made a career out of it, you know, and I don't look back. I want to change a thing that I've done over those years, you know.
My father, he actually did something similar. My recruiter came to my door to pick me up to go sign some paperwork. And he was just so mad. He was an Army guy, so he Marine Corps aside, he didn't want me joining the military, period. But he didn't want to let him in the house. So
our family's a little different then on that. Was my father, my grandfather was in the Navy on my father's side. Uncles on my mother's side were in the Marine Corps in the Navy. My father was in the Marine Corps. Mm-hmm. So when I originally wanted to join, you know, I'm thinking of saying to myself, like, my old man's not going to want me to join the Army. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's not that one's better than the other. Mm-hmm. It's just you have pride in your own organization. Like, me and Cory go back and forth about it all the time, and we usually pick on the Air Force as well. But, I mean, and we throw them all in, but it's all in good jest. You know what I mean? Exactly. So it's... So.
Yeah. Now, as far as the Marines, I talked about Veterans Day, and I don't want to forget about November 10th.
That's the Marine Corps birthday.
I know it is. So
I don't want to say it's the most important day of the year, but it's certainly
it's right up there.
It's certainly up there.
Didn't you just recently get married? So what's the most important day?
Not yet. So I still have a little time.
I don't know if we can quickly, because we don't have a lot of time, unfortunately. Can we quickly go into something during your deployment, which was the most concerning time when you were deployed, or the most stressful time, or was there any incidents like that?
I think each deployment to me was a little bit different. Yeah. I'd say the most stressful thing to me is my deployment in 08-09. I lost Specialist Matthew Pelini to a vehicle accident when we recently got over there. So, like, the most stressful time for me would be that day. The day doesn't go by that I don't think about the kid. You know what I mean? Just, he was a 20-year-old kid that volunteered to go. You know, his life was taken way too short. Mm-hmm. And no fault of his own or anybody else that was involved in it. It was just a tragic accident. Mm-hmm. But there isn't a day go by. So I'd say that's my most stressful.
Mm-hmm. What about yourself, Cory?
There was multiple stressful moments during my deployment. Mm-hmm. Luckily, when I was in there, it wasn't too crazy in the area I was in. Mm-hmm. Just movement from one of the FOBs to the next. Like I said, we did do in theater drops of supplies and stuff like that. So we take some flak going over there, but wasn't anything in particular. Mm-hmm. In one particular moment, it's probably just a culmination of being my first deployment, only deployment, and kind of getting a taste of what it's like over there. So that was probably the most stressful for me.
Yeah, I concur with that. And the thing that stands out in my mind really had nothing to do with my deployment, but when we were over in we were at Dahran Air Base, which is the fighter base right near right on the coast near Bahrain, and just being away from your family, people are well aware. I mean, it's hard on your family back home. It's hard on you, but you got to do what you got to do. And when we were there, it was funny because the Saudis, our counterparts, would work 4-hour shifts, and we would do 12. So they'd have 4 shift changes. So anyway, we were living in a like the little skyscrapers were suites in them because way back the Saudis built these things for the Bedouins that never lived in them. So when we went over there, they said, hey, we got all these buildings, move in. So my unit went, we did our job, and we came home, everyone came home. And probably within within a couple months, there was I think it was a water truck or an oil truck that pulled up to one of these towers that we lived in, that I was living in, and had a bomb in it. And it was probably...
Is that the El Kobar Towers?
Kobar Towers, yeah. Tower. Yeah, so I don't know. I think it was like, I want to say around 30 Air Force members got killed. So then I'm thinking about that, and I'm like, you know, kind of really set in after that, you know, that could have been me, or it could have been my friends, or it could have been anybody, you know. It just, that number was up, and it was just, it hurt, you know. And, it's just the way it is. It's unfortunate, but... That kind of stands out in my mind. I mean, it was a lot of things like you, but overall, very positive, you know.
I would have to say the same. Very, very positive. It's the military is a good thing to do for anybody young that wants to get disciplined. And if they want to go into this field, it's probably only a benefit to them, I'm guessing.
Oh, it definitely gets you on the right track.
Nobody does leadership training like the military does.
Right, no, nobody.
Yeah. I can say that I learned a lot of my life lessons through the Marine Corps that I don't think I would have gotten anywhere else.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for coming on. I appreciate it. We would just like to say happy Veterans Day to all the veterans out there. I'd like to thank all the veterans here for their service and the job they do in the police department. And they've obviously all sacrificed a lot, and we do appreciate it day to day. So thank you very much from the Chief of Police, Chief Dan Rosa. I thank him also for allowing us to do this. And thank you all, guys.
Thanks.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Sergeant.
Thank you.